Hello students, Assalamu alaikum. Today we are going to learn about nuclear physics. So this is lesson 6. So already we have seen about nuclear physics. So now we will again see about nuclear physics and its part 2. So we know that humans are very much interested in knowing about atoms. Things around us are made up of atoms. A Greek philosopher, Democritus, in 400 BC believed that matter is made up of tiny indestructible units called atoms. Later in 1803, John Dalton considered that elements consist of atoms which are identical in nature. J.J. Thomson discovered cathode rays known as electrons experimentally, and later Goldstein discovered positive rays which are named as protons by Rutherford. In 1932, James Hardwick discovered the charged particles called neutrons. So, at present, a large number of elementary particles like photon, meson, positron, and neutrino have been discovered. In 1911, the British scientist Ernest Rutherford explained that the mass of an atom is concentrated in its central part called nucleus. So the atoms and nucleus are known to humans for about a century. So the nuclear physics is the field of physics that studies the building blocks and interactions of atomic nuclei. It includes the study of the general properties of nucleus, the particles contained in the nucleus, the interaction between these particles, radioactivity and nuclear reactions, and the practical applications of nuclear physics. So it all started with the discovery of radioactivity. In 1896, French physicist Henri Becquerel found the radioactive material. So every atom contains a center, an extremely dense positively charged nucleus. The nucleus is made of protons and neutrons. As we all know, the electrons that revolve around the nucleus carries negative charge, and it has been revolving around the nucleus, and the nucleus contains protons and neutrons. There protons have positive electric charge and the neutrons have no electric charge. So this forms the dense nucleus. So the energy in the nucleus is harnessed in nuclear physics. So the radioactivity is the spontaneous emission of radiation by unstable nuclei to become stable. To attain the stability, they emit alpha particles, beta particles, and gamma rays. So the alpha particles are nothing but helium. The atomic number decreases by 2 and the mass number increases by 4. And the beta particles are electrons and positrons. So when the nucleus emit beta particles, the atomic number changes by 1 and the mass number remains the same, and the gamma rays are energetic photons. So the alpha, beta and gamma rays are emitted when a radioactive nucleus undergoes radioactivity, and they are harmful radiations. So now we will learn about the half lifetime. So half lifetime is nothing but the time taken by the nucleus to release the alpha, beta and gamma rays, which are known as alpha decay, beta decay, and also as gamma decay. So the half-life means the time required for the disintegration of half of the sample of radioactive material. Half-lifetime period is different for different elements. For example, in the picture you can see uranium, thorium, radium, radon, plutonium, lead, bismuth have different half-lifetime periods. So in radioactivity there are two types of reactions. So a nuclear reaction is a rearrangement of nuclear components induced by particle bombardment. So fission and fusion are the two nuclear reactions. So the nuclear reactions are subject to the following conservation laws: charge, momentum and angular momentum, energy, and the total number of nucleons. So the nuclear fission was found by German scientist Otto Hahn and F. Strassmann. They discovered that when a uranium nucleus is bombarded with neutron, it breaks up into two smaller nuclei of comparable mass along with the emission of few neutrons and energy. So this process of breaking up of a heavier nucleus into two smaller nuclei with the release of large amount of energy and a few neutrons is called nuclear fission. So nuclear fission is the splitting of large nucleus to smaller ones, results in the liberation of energy. So in this reaction, uranium, which has the mass number of 235, is bombarded with a neutron and it has been fissioned into many smaller particles. So it is the nuclear fission of a uranium nucleus. The average energy released in each fission process is about 3.2 into 10 power minus 11 joules. So you can see the nuclear fission is pictorically represented in the figure. So in this reaction, more than 200 metric volt energy is released. So you can see in the reaction, when the uranium is bombarded, it creates barium and krypton. A fissionable material is a radioactive element which undergoes fission in a sustained manner when it absorbs a neutron. It is also termed as fissile material. Example, uranium and plutonium. All isotopes of uranium do not undergo nuclear fission when they absorb a neutron. For example, natural uranium consists of 99.28% of uranium-238 and 0.72% of uranium-235. Of these two, uranium-238 does not undergo fission, whereas uranium-235 undergo fission. Hence, uranium-235 is a fissionable material and uranium-238 is a non-fissionable. There are some radioactive elements which can be converted into fissionable material and they are called fertile materials. Example, uranium-238, thorium-232 and plutonium-240. So this nuclear fission will take place in a reactor. So the place where controlled fission chain reaction occurs. So it is the place where controllable chain reaction occurs. So the liberated energy is used for the production of the electricity. So the parts of the reactor are fuel, uranium, plutonium and thorium. So the moderator used here is water, graphite to slow down the neutron, and the control rods, cadmium that absorb the neutrons, and the concrete wall block to control the radiations. So a nuclear reactor is a device in which the nuclear fission reaction takes place in a self-sustained and controlled manner to produce electricity. The first nuclear reactor was built in 1942 at Chicago, USA. And there are several types of nuclear reactors. They are breeding reactor, fast breeder reactor, pressurized water reactor, pressurized heavy water reactor, boiling water reactor, water cooled reactor, gas cooled reactor, fusion reactor, and a thermal reactor are some types of nuclear reactors which are used in different places worldwide. And the components of the nuclear reactor you can see in the picture. They are fuel, moderator, control rod, coolant and protection wall. First, fuel. A fissile material is used as the fuel. The commonly used fuel material is uranium. Then moderator. A moderator is used to slow down the high energy neutrons. Then control rods. Control rods are used to control the number of neutrons in order to have sustained chain reaction. Mostly boron or cadmium rods are used as the control rods. Coolant. Coolant is used to remove the heat produced in the reactor core. A protection wall. A thick concrete lead wall is built around the nuclear reactor in order to prevent the harmful radiations from escaping into the environment. We have learned that energy can be produced when a heavy nucleus is split up into smaller nuclei. Similarly, energy can be produced when two lighter nuclei combine to form a heavier nucleus. This phenomenon is known as nuclear fission. Here the two light nuclei is fused together to form a heavier nucleus results in the liberation of energy. So the two helium atoms, two hydrogen atoms are combined to form helium plus neutron, and it produces 17.6 metric volt by releasing the energy of about 3.84 into 10 power minus 12 joules. So in radioactivity, there are two types: natural radioactivity and artificial radioactivity. So in natural radioactivity, the emission of radiation due to self-integration of a nucleus. Alpha, beta and gamma radiations are emitted. It is a spontaneous process and it is exhibited by elements with atomic number more than 83, and natural radioactivity cannot be controlled. In artificial radioactivity, the emission of radiation due to disintegration of nucleus, it is through the induced process. Mostly elementary particles such as neutron, positron, etc. are emitted. It is an induced process exhibited by elements with atomic number less than 83, and artificial radioactivity can be controlled. So in artificial and in natural radioactivity, alpha, beta and gamma rays are emitted and they have certain properties. The alpha rays are the helium nucleus consisting of two protons and two neutrons. They are electrons, basically elementary particles in all atoms. They are electromagnetic waves consisting of photons. So the alpha rays are positively charged particles. Charge of each alpha particle is plus 2e. So it is 100 times greater, the ionizing power is 100 times greater than of the beta rays and 10,000 times greater than of the gamma rays. So the alpha rays have low penetrating power, and the beta rays, they are electrons and basic elementary particle in all atoms. So the beta rays are negatively charged particles and the ionizing power is comparatively low, and the penetrating power of the beta rays is greater than that of a alpha ray. They can penetrate to thin metal foil, whereas the gamma rays are electromagnetic waves consisting of photons, and they are the neutral particles. Charge of each gamma particle is equal to zero, and they have very less ionizing power. They have very high penetrating power, greater than that of the beta rays, and they can penetrate through thick metal blocks, and the gamma rays can travel with the speed of the light. Now we will see about the difference between the nuclear fission and nuclear fission. So the nuclear fission is the process of breaking up of heavy nucleus into two smaller nuclei. It's called nuclear fission, and it can be performed at a room temperature, whereas the nuclear fusion is the combination of two lighter nuclei to form a heavier nucleus. And extremely high temperature and pressure is needed to perform the nuclear fusion process. Next, the uses of radioactivity. Many radioisotopes can be obtained from radioactivity. These radioisotopes have found wide variety of applications in the field of medicine, agriculture, industry and archaeological research. We will see one by one. In agriculture, the radioisotope of phosphorus P32 helps to increase the productivity of crops. The radiation from the isotopes can be used to kill the insects and parasites and prevent the wastage of agricultural products. In medicine, medical application of radioisotopes can be divided into two parts. The medical application of radioisotopes can be divided into two parts, diagnosis and therapy. Radioisotopes are used as tracers to diagnose the nature of the circulatory disorders of blood, defects of bone metabolism, to locate tumors, etc. For example, the radio cobalt CO60 and the radio gold AU198 are used in the treatment of skin cancer, and the radiations are used to sterilize the surgical devices as they can kill germs and microbes. In industries, radioactive isotopes are used as tracers to detect any manufacturing defects such as cracks and leaks. Packaging faults can also be identified through radioactivity. Gauges which have radioactive sources are used in many industries to check the level of gases, liquids and solids. An isotope of californium CF-252 is used in the airlines to detect the explosive in the luggage. An isotope of americium AM-241 is used in many industries as a smoke detector. And in archaeological research, using the technique of radiocarbon dating, the age of the earth, fossils, old paintings and monuments can be determined. In radiocarbon dating, the existing amount of radiocarbon is determined, and this gives an estimate about the age of the things. Safety measures. So in day-to-day life, you do receive some natural radiation from the sun. So likewise, so radioisotopes are used and nowadays used in many fields. So the improper and careless handling of radioactive materials release harmful radiations in our environment, and these radiations are very harmful to the human body. A person who is exposed to radiations very closely or for a longer duration is at a greater health risk and can be affected genetically. So the International Commission of Radiological Protection ICRP has recommended certain maximum permissible exposure limits to radiation that is believed to be safe without producing any appreciable injury to a person. So the safe limit of overall exposure to radiation is given as 20 millisievert per year. In terms of Ranjan, the safe limit of receiving the radiation is about 100 milliRanjan per week. If the exposure is 100 Ranjan, it may cause fatal diseases like leukemia or cancer. So leukemia is the death of red blood corpuscle in the blood. When the body is exposed to 600 Ranjan, it leads to the death. So dosimeter is the device used to detect the level of exposure to an ionizing radiation. It is frequently used in environment where exposure to radiation may occur, such as nuclear power plants. So that's all about today's class. So the assignment, boys and girls, kindly write in your assignment note neatly and send a picture to the respective teacher. So you take the screenshot of the questions, and after completing the assignments, kindly send it to the particular teacher. So with this, in science, the physics portions are over. I hope that apart from writing the assignments, you can also study these questions, and as you are in home, try to write and see the answers, and you can correct it by yourself so that you will be ready for the upcoming public exam. Thank you. This is Sharif.